श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः। वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग टू वन एंड ऑल। लेट मी बिगिन विथ ए स्मॉल प्रेयर। ईश्वरो गुरुरात्मेति मूर्ति भेद विभागिने व्योमवत् व्याप्त देहाय श्री दक्षिणा मूर्तये नमः। This is Nitin Sridhar of Advaita Academy and a warm welcome to all of you to the second session on Sri Madhusudana Saraswati by Dr. Niranjan Saha. Welcome back, Dr. Niranjan ji, and thank you for appearing on our show. Viewers, this talk is being held under our newly started segment called Life and Works of Advaita Acharyas. The purpose of this new segment is to introduce you to different Advaita Acharyas and their works, their contribution to the Advaita Sampradaya, their contribution to Sanatana Dharma as a whole. Because often Vedanta is identified most strongly with Sri Adi Shankaracharya Bhagavatpada, and rightly so, because his contribution is immense, immeasurable, and we must all be grateful to him for his contribution to not just the Vedanta, but the Hindu parampara, to Sanatana Dharma, to the revival of Sanatana Dharma as a whole. However, we must, as a Vedantin, as a Vedanta enthusiast, as students of Vedanta, or as a simply a practicing Hindu, we must remember that the greatest uniqueness of Sanatana Dharma is we are a living tradition. We have a living Guru Parampara. So before Shankaracharya Bhagavatpada, there were also Vedantin teachers. And after Shankara Bhagavatpada, also there have been Vedantin teachers. And all of them have been equally contributed to the sustenance of this tradition, to the enrichment of this tradition. As the Guru Parampara mantra says, Sadashiva Samarambham Shankaracharya Madhyamam Asmadacharya Paryantam Vande Guru Parampara. So keeping this mantra in mind, we have started this session. And yesterday, Dr. Niranjan ji spoke quite exhaustively about the life, the biography of Sri Madhusudana Saraswati, one of the tallest Advaita Vedantin in the last millennia. And today he will be speaking more about his work, his different works, the philosophy, etc. So with this opening remarks, I welcome and I invite Dr. Niranjan to start his session. And whatever doubts, questions you have, please leave it in Q&A box. Towards the end, maybe 15 minutes or 20 minutes, Dr. Niranjan ji will take up these questions. Sir, please start your session.
Sure. Namo Gurubha. Just before before I start my talk, I want to show you this book, The Precept of Advaita, edited by Professor T.M.P. Mahadevan. Will supplement this series. You know, here the details of most of the famous preceptors of Advaita Vedanta. Since pre Shankaras and until the modern preceptors also. You know, you will get the details, particularly the biographical details and the works of those preceptors. Anyway, yesterday we tried to make the historical veracity and biographical sketch of Madhusudana. And based on this talk yesterday, what I tried to make, we'll see that Madhusudana was, Madhusudana's mastery in different Indian philosophical schools. Because when we discussed yesterday, and the socio-cultural scenario in which Madhusudana was born and the historical veracity, we saw his, you know, the mastery in different Indian philosophical schools. And this his master in different philosophical schools is invariably reflected in his works, though there is a the scholars are not in agreement in terms of the number of works Bodhisattva can be attributed to, but based on different catalogs, the number one is the Theory of Optics, the Theory of Optics catalogus catalogum, and the National Catalog catalogus catalogum of the University of Madras, and the literature of Aditya Vedanta by Professor Tangaswamy. And I've also consulted the Indian philosophy, the bibliography of Indian philosophies edited by Professor Karl Porter. And based on this catalog, I have just tried to list the works which are attributed to Madhusudana. As I mentioned to you, some of the works are accepted by the tradition to have been authored by Madhusudana, and some of them are accepted by the tradition to be the works of Madhusudana, though they are less certain. That means some works, the authorship of some works are more likely, and the authorship of some works is less certain. And on the basis of primary evidence, namely references to Madhusudana's teachers and or to his own name in the colophons and the internal references among the works, we could enlist the following works, such as Advaita Siddhi, Advaita Ratrakshana, Bhagavad Bhakti Rasayana, Bhagavad Gita Gurartha Deepika, Bhagavad Purana Prathama Shloka Vyakha, Ishwara Pratipatti Prakasha, Mahimna Stotra Tika, including Prasthana Bheda Dayarin, Sankshipa Sharirika Sara Sangraha, Siddhanta Bindu, and Vedanta Kalpalatika to the works of Madhusudana. These works are considered to have been authored by Madhusudana, and which are considered to be more likely written by Madhusudana. The authenticity of the authorship of the following works is more doubtful, which are Ashtavikriti Vivarana or Vibriti, Ananda Mandakini, Atma Madhava Tika, Hari Lila Vyakha, Krishna Kutuhula Nataka, Raghupati Bodha, Shandila Sutra Tika, Shastra Siddhanta Lesha Tika, and Vedastuti Tika. So these works are accepted by the tradition to have been authored by Madhusudana, but due to lack of evidence, these works are considered to be, less likelihood compared to the earlier works. So now let us give a brief note of each of the 19 works text attributed to Madhusudana in order to obtain an idea of the nature and subject matter of his works. Though out of these 19 works, we have been able to consult the first 15 works, whereas the last four have not been found due to their unavailability in printed form or because they are spurious. That means that out of 19 works, 15 works I could, I've been able to consult. The last four I got just mentioned in different catalog and catalogum, but I could not, consult the works. So let us just discuss, as you mentioned, the works, just giving the, what is called, the subject matter and the salient features of each work. So we'll just discuss the first group of the works. In that group, the first work comes, which is Advaita Siddhi. As you know, Advaita Siddhi is considered to be the magnum opus of Madhusudana Saraswati. Its authorship can easily be ascertained by the colophon of each of the chapters, that Rama, Vishesha Saraswati, and Madhava are his preceptors, and that he belongs to the monastic order, which is stated by Madhusudana at the beginning of his work. It refers to other works of the author, like the Gurartha Deepika, Siddhanta Bindu, Vedanta Kalpalatika, etc. The very name of the work, Advaita plus Siddhi, Advaita means Advaita Vedanta, non-dualistic Vedanta, and Siddhi means accomplishment. It indicates its importance in the field of Advaita Vedanta philosophy. By composing this work, not only has he conveyed the final extent of Advaita Vedanta and accomplished his purpose in refuting the realistic doctrine of the Nayayikas and the dualist Vedantic school of Madhva, but it has also given him a permanent place among the exponents of Postshankara Advaita Vedanta. So it is said that, you know, Advaita Siddhi is considered to be the last original work in Postshankara era. It is an original work of Madhusudana written in dialectical style. It also explains the Brahma Sutras, the Sruti texts, and many of the verses of the Bhagavad Gita by shedding new light on them. The ultimate goal, the experience of the divine bliss, or Brahmananda, Madhusudana mentions in his work, is due to the greatness of his teachers and his own study of the different branches of knowledge. The Advaita Siddhi is divided into four chapters, which are four chedas. Each chapter is subdivided into minor sections, adhikaranas, the disputation pertaining to the status of the world, whether it is a real or illusory, in 60 sections, the determination of the nature of Atma Brahman as identical with the individual self in 34 sections. That means I'm just mentioning how the, you know, how the contents of Advaita Siddhi in nutshell. The superiority of listening to the Vedanta scriptures to that of logical examination of the Vedantic doctrine and of constant dwelling on it as a means of internal realization, it 8 sections, and the demonstration of the nature of liberation, etc., in 6 subheadings have been dealt with in the text corresponding to its 4 chapters. These are Prapancha Mithyatva Nirupana, Atma Nirupana, Samanadi Nirupana, and Bhukti Nirupana, respectively. So these are the 4 chapters of Advaita Siddhi. Among the commentaries on the Advaita Siddhi, the Laghu Chandrika and Guru Chandrika or Brihat Chandrika by Brahmananda Saraswati, 16th century to the 17th century C, Siddhi Vyakha by Balabhadra, 16th century C, the Vitthalopadhyayi by Vitthalopadhyaya, 18th century C. Sorry, that is the name of the commentary is Vitthalopadhyayi by Vitthalopadhyaya, 18th century C. Balabhadini by Jagannatha Tathagatitta is the latest Sanskrit commentary of Advaita Siddhi, on Advaita Siddhi. Deserves a special mention. There is also a summary of the text called the Advaita Siddhi, Siddhanta Sara by Sadananda Vyasa, 16th century C. Though there is a variation in the Kumbhakaram edition, in the Kumbhakaram, the first chapter is divided into 52 sections. But the details what I have mentioned about Advaita Siddhi, actually I followed the Purimal Publications edition. I think that is actually the reprint of Nirnaya Sagara edition. Next comes Advaita Ratna Rakshana. This too is a dialectical work in 20 different topics as a refutation of the Bheda Ratna of the realistic dualist Nayayika Shankara Mishra, 1542 to 1542 CE. Its authorship can be attributed to Madhusudana with its reference to his other works, like the Advaita Siddhi, Vedanta Kalpalatika, and Siddhanta Bindu. And through his mention in the colophon of his teacher, Visheshwara Saraswati, to whom he dedicates this work. The use of harsh language against the young Nayayikas who are not content with his masterpiece Advaita Siddhi, and the unavailability of any reference to his work in any of his other works, show that the Advaita Ratna Rakshana might be the last original work of Parishadana Saraswati. Bhakti Rasayana, or the next work is Bhakti Rasayana or Bhagavad Bhakti Rasayana. It is mentioned, I should mention that we'll see that Madhusudana was not only a prolific writer in the tradition of Advaita, he at the same time he was a remarkable writer and bhakti too, being an ardent follower of Shankara. So this work, Bhakti Rasayana or Bhagavad Bhakti Rasayana, is one of the most important works of Madhusudana Saraswati on his philosophy of devotion. He closely followed the Bhagavata Purana in defining devotion bhakti here. It consists of three divisions, ullashas. The colophon of each of the three divisions of the work confirms the authorship of Madhusudana Saraswati. Besides this reference, the work refers to his Siddhanta Bindu and the Vedanta Kalpalotika. The first ullasa, that is Bhakti Samanya Nirupana, describes the general characteristics of devotion, its means and the stages of it. The second ullasa, which is called Bhakti Vishesha Pratipadaka, deals with the special characteristics of devotion. And the third one, that is Bhakti Rasa Pratipadaka, determines the nature of emotional sentiment of devotion, Bhakti Rasa respectively. Though there are three divisions of the text, the author's own commentary on the first ullasa, called the Sarupa Sadhana, is only available to us. That means, though there are four ullashas, but only we find the commentary on the first ullasa by Madhusudana himself. The next work is Bhagavad Gita Gudartha Deepika, Madhusudana's most voluminous work on religious philosophy, is his commentary on the Bhagavad Gita called the Gurartha Deepika. The colophons at the end of each chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, Gurartha Deepika, imply almost in the same wording as those of the chapters of his Samkshepa Sharirika Shala Sangraha, another work we'll be just talking of, and the Advaita Ratnarakshana. Moreover, his commentary on the Gita refers to his other works like the Siddhanta Bindu, Bhakti Rasayana, Advaita Siddhi, etc. Besides, while conveying his gratitude to his teachers, namely Rama, Vishveshwara, and Madhava, Madhusudana used almost the same expression in both the Advaita Siddhi and Gurartha Deepika. The Gurartha Deepika is widely accepted but not extensively studied running commentary on the Bhagavad Gita. In spite of his utmost reverence to the faith of Shankara's Advaita Vedanta, the aim of Madhusudana in writing this commentary on the Bhagavad Gita deserves careful philosophical consideration. To Madhusudana, the main teaching of the Bhagavad Gita is that the unqualified Brahman, Nirguna Brahman, could be attained through the way of loving devotion to the Lord, that is Bhakti Marga. Therefore, he didn't abstain from even differing openly from Shankara's commentary on the Gita, albeit Madhusudana accepted Shankara's views on the nature of liberation and his interpretations of the principal doctrines of Advaita Vedanta. This is very much available, you know, particularly the commentary on his on Bhagavad Gita 1866, Sarvadharman Parityajya Mamekangshanam Vraja. The next work is Bhagavata Purana Prathama Shloka Vyakha. This is another theological work of Madhusudana. It is the commentary on only the first verse of the Bhagavata Purana called the Paramhansa Priya. The commentary of Madhusudana on the first sloka of Bhagavata Purana is called Paramhansa Priya. The only work of Madhusudana referred to in this book is Bhakti Rasayana. Besides, the treatment of metaphysical aspect in this work seems to be distinctive of our author. So, the explanation of the Upanishad, Shatavata, of the Pancharatri school of Puranika and of Kevala Bhakti are found respectively in this elucidation of the first verse of Madhusudana, of the first verse of Bhagavata Purana. We should just mention here one of the translator and critical editor of Madhusudana's work, I mentioned yesterday, P.C. Devanji, he thinks that this work actually, that at the end of the work, that all the varieties of emotional sentiment of devotion has also been mentioned in the Bhakti Rasayana, and some of them will be dealt with here. Also, it seems that the author had the intention to write a commentary either on the whole work or on a greater part of it. It is just his conjecture, because we only find why Madhusudana wrote only commentary on the first sloka of the Bhagavad Purana, not on the whole book. The next work, another theological work of Madhusudana, is called Harilila Vyakha. Harilila Vyakha is a commentary on the Harilamritam, a summary of the Bhagavata Purana by Bhopadeva, 13th century CE. It's called Bhagavata Purana, Prathama Shloka Vyakha, I have just mentioned, which is also known as the Paramahansa Priya in this work. Though there is no reference to any of his teachings in this work, colophon of each of the 12 chapters attributed to Madhusudana as the author of this work. The name of Madhusudana as its writer is also found in the last concluding verse of this work, that is in Harilila Vyakha. Abhankar Shastri, another editor of Madhusudana's work, he has edited a book of Madhusudana's work, Siddhanta Bindu, published from Pune, has mentioned in the introduction that a different Madhusudana as the author of this work, though without giving any substantial proof. But there are several inner proofs which can substantiate the claim that Madhusudana was the author of this work. Here, the author frequently referred to the views of his predecessors on the Bhagavad Purana, like Purushottama and Siddhartha, etc. With regards to this work, Visi Devanji is doubtful about his authorship and says there is no reference to any other work of Madhusudana in this work. And P.M. Modi, another translator of Madhusudana's works, dims in the work of Madhusudana and also says that the author doesn't refer to any of his works here. He dims that another commentary on the Bhagavata bearing the same name, Paramahansa Priya, at the time of Madhusudana. That means he would just be doubtful whether that Paramahansa Priya is written by Madhusudana, or it could have been written by other author bearing the same name. The next work is called Mahimna Stotrika, including the Prasthana Veda therein. This text is a commentary on the Mahimna Stotra of Pushpadantacharya. Apparently, it is a eulogy of Lord Shiva, Hara. While being an ardent devotee of Lord Vishnu, Hari, Madhusudana has interpreted it, the original work, as praising both Lord Shiva and Lord Vishnu. Both the introductory verse and the colophon at the end of the work support Madhusudana's authorship of it, where he refers to his preceptor, Visheshwara. Moreover, Madhusudana's Vedantakalpalatika is referred to in this work. The commentary on the verse 7 deserves a special mention here, because this is actually named as Prasthana Veda, and sometimes this book is also available as an independent work. The commentary on the verse 7 is of special mention, since the author here gives a complete list of works in Sanskrit on different branches of knowledge as he found in his time. Considering the Prasthana Veda as an independent work, the content of verse 7 might have been altered by later scholars. That's the typical thing. So the Prasthana Veda can be attributed as being a part of the Mahimna Stotrika, other than being an independent work of the author. So sometimes we find that Prasthana Veda as an independent work, printed one, and sometimes we find that it is a part of the Mahimna Stotrika, also contains the Prasthana Veda. The next important work in this tradition, theological work, is called Sankshipa Sharireka Sara Sangraha. As you know, Sankshipa Sharireka is a summary of the commentary on the Brahma Sutra of Shankara by Sarvakrita Muni in versified form. The Bhagavad's commentary on it, called the Sankshipa Sharireka Sara Sangraha, doesn't have any reference to any of his other works, and the vice versa, it can be placed among the works of our author with the help of other internal evidences we find in different works of Madhusudana. The first line of the second benedictory verse of this commentary, which states the names of his teachers, corresponds to the second benedictory verse of his Advaita Siddhi and the last concluding verse of chapter 18 of his Gita commentary respectively. He has given a scholarly interpretation of the Sankshipa Sharireka of Sarvakrita Muni in an independent manner. The sympathetic attitude of the author of the Sankshipa Sharireka towards Nirguna Bhakti Marga, Purvata Madhusudana, deal with this subject. The next work is called Siddhanta Bindu. As I mentioned yesterday in passing, it's a commentary by Madhusudana on the Dashastalaki of Shankara. This is also called the Chidananda Saloki. The reason for undertaking this work has been mentioned by the author himself. At the beginning of the work, the author has paid homage to his teacher Visheshara. The colophon of this book has similarity with that of the Advaita Ratna Rakshana. There are also references to the Vedanta Kalpalatika in this book. The work gives a detailed explanation of the perceptual process as admitted in the Advaita Vedanta. It brings out the import of the Dashastalaki of Shankara with far more subtlety than it appears at first. Actually, I mentioned yesterday, Siddhanta Bindu is of course a dialectical work, not the way the higher splitting, you know, reasoning you find in Advaita Siddhi, though it also delineates the entire philosophy of Advaita philosophy in a nutshell. It can be considered one of the independent works or authentic works in this tradition. Here, Devanji, in his 1933 introduction, mentions that on the basis of different information available on different catalogs. He mentioned the Indian official catalog, the absence of complete colophon in this work, which states in the form of thus ends the chapters. We'll just come to this point. The next, it's regarding the Vedanta Kalpalatika. Yeah. The next work is Vedanta Kalpalatika. It is one of the earliest works of the author, as it seems to have referred to no other works of the author but the Siddhanta Bindu. In the second introductory verse, the author salutes his teacher, Visheshara, though there is no mention of his teacher in the colophon of this work. The similarity of expression to that of the other works of the author authenticates the author's authorship of Madhusudana. It seems to be an incomplete work, like the Bhakti Rasayana. In this regard, Devanji mentioned that on the basis of different catalogs, Almitra, it should be Almitra, Nursiya Sanskrit manuscript, volume number 4, and the Indian office catalog, and the absence of complete colophon in this work, which exists in the form of thus ends the chapter, Stavaka, in the Vedanta Kalpalatika. Instead of thus ends the Vedanta Kalpalatika, Devanji opines that the text is incomplete and it has only one chapter. The text deserves importance in various regions, the Vedanta Kalpalatika, by giving short summaries of the tenets of different Indian philosophical schools. It deals with them as contrasted with Vedantic views. Discussions pertaining to the nature of emancipation, moksha, and the means of realizing it, the nature of self-knowledge as compared with the Upanishadic and other schools, destruction of ignorance, the nature of the senses, and the means of achieving emancipation as self, being freed from ignorance, etc., comprise the subject matter of the Vedanta Bhagavatika. Besides, there is a passage which seems to have thrown light on the way of devotion, Bhakti Marga, as followed by Madhusudana. I should have mentioned that in Siddhanta Bhujus also, we have a number of, you know, some commentary. Though Siddhanta Bhujus itself a commentary on Shankara Siloki, it deserves to be an independent work. We find there are a number of sub-commentaries on Siddhanta Bhujus, on by Narayana Titta, on by Brahmananda, and on the Purushottama Saraswati, and Purushottama Saraswati. These three commentaries are most important in the tradition. Now, let us discuss the works, the authorship of which is less certain. In this group, the first work is called Ashta Vikriti Vivarana or Vibriti. The Ashta Vikriti Vivarana or Vibriti or the Yugaveda Jata Adha Ashta Vikriti Vivarana, it is also regarded as this, is a methodical work concerned with the eight modes of chanting the Vedic hymns. In the beginning verse, the author introduced himself to be a Mashkari. Mashkari means the religious ascetic of the name of Madhusudana and a disciple of the renowned Krishna Dvaipayana. The colophon of the word ends in the form, thus ends the Ashta Vikriti Vivarana. No additional information is found there. Besides, Madhusudana introduces himself often in his other works like the Advaita Siddhi, Purartha Deepika, etc., as a muni, the meaning of which carries more philosophical implication than the term Mashkari. And we have seen earlier that Madhusudana declares himself as being a disciple of Visheshwara Saraswati and not of Krishna Dvaipayana in his other works. That means, you know, in this book we find that Madhusudana describes himself as Mashkari rather than Muni, and he describes himself as a disciple of Krishna Dvaipayana rather than a disciple of Visheshwara Saraswati. And this information indicates that this work may not be, you know, written by Madhusudana. So we can conclude with clear certainty this work among other works of our author, though we have that printed version of this work. The next one is Ananda Mandakini. This is a work praising Lord Krishna and is based on the legends as depicted in the Bhagavata Purana. It is a poetic work consisting 102 stanzas. The last two verses of the work bear the title and the name of its author. Though Vasudeva Shastri Abhankar, one of the editors of Madhusudana's work, mentions one Madhusudana Saraswati, who is the disciple of Sridhara Saraswati and who is the author of the Ananda Mandakini. There he didn't provide any evidence in support of it. Besides, we have already noted that Madhusudana didn't mention Sridhara Saraswati in any of his works as his teacher. There is no reference to this work in any other work of Madhusudana and vice versa. Nor does it refer to any of his teachers referred to in his other works. The colophon of the work also is distinctly different from those of his other works. Though it is stated that Madhusudana is the author, barring the eulogy of Lord Krishna, the work doesn't show any sign of erudite mindset of our author of the Advaita Siddhi. So it has been excluded from the list of Madhusudana's works. The next one is Atmabodha Tika. Atmabodha Tika is on the basis of a manuscript where the colophon states that this commentary is written by Madhusudana Saraswati. This work is treated to be authored by Madhusudana Advaita Siddhi. In this regard, Bishop Devanji has mentioned that there is a notice of manuscript of the Atmabodha Tika by Madhusudana Saraswati in Alil Mitra's Alil Mitra edited notice of Sanskrit manuscripts, where the word Atmabodha and Prakarana is described as the Sarva Vedanta Siddhanta Sangraha, which indicates that it must be the one of Shankara's Atmabodha and not of Madhusudana's work. However, it was printed by the Sanskrit College, Calcutta, later on in 1961, which we have been able to procure. It is a book on the Atmabodha Prakarana of Shankaracharya with a commentary ascribed generally to Madhusudana, though there is no reference to Madhusudana in the colophon. So the learned editor too expresses his doubt about its authorship, though he deems it a useful commentary to understand the Atmabodha Prakarana of Shankaracharya. In this regard, Abhankar Shastri, Vasudeva Abhankar Shastri, maintains that the writer of this work is also the commentator of the Atmabodha, Advaita Siddhi, Siddhanta Bindu, Siddhanta Lesha. His view cannot be accepted due to the lack of evidence. That means, in support of his view, Abhankar Shastri mentions that the Madhusudana Saraswati, who is the author of Advaita Siddhi, Siddhanta Bindu, Siddhanta Lesha Sangraha, is also the author of Atmabodha Tika, though he didn't provide any substantial proof. It is also not referred to in any of Madhusudana's works mentioned above. Thus, it should not be included in the list and is to be discarded from the list of the works of Madhusudana. The next important work among this, in this list, is Ishvara Pratipatti Prakasha. This short text was first edited by T. Ganapati Shastri from Trivandrum in 1921, where in his brief preface, he mentions the author as also the writer of the Gurartha Deepika and Advaita Siddhi, without giving any conclusive evidence in favor of his claim. There is no mention of any of the teachers of our author, nor does it have any of the common features of the colophons we find in his other works, excepting the statement that Madhusudana Saraswati is the author of the work. Though no other works of our author is referred to here, nor any of them refers to it by name, P.M. Modi and P.C. Devanji have firmly advocated that this work must be from Madhusudana's pen. Modi opines that the points like the nature of God, the three states of self, that is waking Jagrat, dream Shapna, deep sleep Sushupti, and the explanation of the term Pranava, etc., have been discussed in detail in Madhusudana's other works like Siddhanta Bindu, Siddhanta Bindu, Vedanta Kalpatartika, Mahimstatra Tika, and Bhagavata Purana Puthama Suloka Vyakha, etc. Following the path of Modi, Devanji has observed that Siddhanta Bindu has explained some of the points of Ishvara Pratipatti Prakasha in detail, and the content of this work is quite consistent with the essence of the Bhakti Rasayana and the Mahimastutra Tika of our author. But merely because of Madhusudana's recurrent acceptance of the views of his predecessors in this work, where those predecessors might have discussed the same issues with the same ends in different books, we cannot accept this work as one of our author's work with surety. The next work is Krishna Kutuhala Nataka. Though like the Atmabodha Tika, this work too has been assigned to be the work of Madhusudana, it has no reference to any of his other works, nor does it mention any of his teachers known to us. It is mentioned in the colophon that the illustrious Mark Madhusudana Saraswati is the author of the work. It is a devotional work written in the form of dialogue drama in seven acts with literary acumen. The biographical details that the author was the disciple of Krishna Saraswati and that he was the son of Arundhati and Narayana of the Sandilya clan Gatra, as mentioned here, contradict the sources we have made use of in drawing the biographical details of which I spoke yesterday. Abhankara Shastri also refers to one Madhusudana Saraswati, a disciple of Sridhara Saraswati, to be the author of this work. But it seems to be based on conjecture only, thus this work can be excluded from the list of Madhusudana Saraswati. Of course, in this regard, for a critical note on this work, one might refer to Devanji's introduction to Siddhanta Bindu, published in 1933 from Puna Bhandari Collection Institute. Next work is Raga Putibodha. This work too is attributed to Madhusudana on the basis of a manuscript, but it has no reference to other works of Madhusudana and vice versa. Besides, the author appears there to be one Madhusudana Saraswati, the disciple of Akhandananda, which contradicts our authentic sources regarding the preceptor of Madhusudana. The content of the work too doesn't also seem to be consistent with the taste of our author, as we find in other works of Madhusudana, the authentic works of Madhusudana. So it is definitely not a work written by our author, Madhusudana Saraswati. As we've mentioned that among these 19 works, we've been able to procure first 15 works, I mean, until this Raga Putibodha Tika, starting from Advaita Siddhi. Now this four works, the Raga Putibodha also I couldn't locate, only we just found, mentioned it in different catalog. And these three works, that is Shandilya Sutra Tika, then Shastra Siddhanta Lesha Tika and Vidhistuti Tika also we couldn't locate. Though all the above three works have been catalogued by Theodore Afrev, none of them is referred to in any of the known works of Madhusudana Saraswati. Abhankara Shastri, however, mentions one Madhusudana Saraswati as the commentator of the Vidhistuti without supplying any evidence to prove his stand. Thus, no opinion can be made about the authorship of these works, but it is highly, highly improbable for Madhusudana to write a commentary on the Siddhanta Lesha Sangraha, whose author Appal Dikshita was his contemporary. So, based on the above discussion and the internal references as we found in his works, we can just chronologize the works this way, or we can just mention the internal references among his works. We'll be just chronologizing a bit later. The Advaita Siddhi refers to the Gurartha Deepika, Siddhanta Bindu, and the Vedanta Kalpalatika. The Advaita Ratna Rakshana refers to the Advaita Siddhi and Vedanta Kalpalatika. The Bhakti Rasayana refers to the Siddhanta Bindu and Vedanta Kalpalatika. The Gurartha Deepika refers to the Siddhanta Bindu, Bhakti Rasayana, and the Advaita Siddhi. The Bhagavata Purana Prathama Shalaka refers to the Bhakti Rasayana. The Horilila Vyakha refers to the Bhagavata Purana Prathama Shalaka Vyakha. The Mohimna Stotra Tika refers to the Vedanta Kalpalatika. The Siddhanta Bindu refers to the Vedanta Kalpalatika, and the Vedanta Kalpalatika refers to the Siddhanta Bindu. So, having found the cross references in his works, regarding the chronology of Madhusudana's work, as you find in the discussion, Sankshipa Sharirika Sara Sangraha seems to be the earliest one. It has no reference to any of his works or vice versa. By keeping the position intact as a commentator, he dealt with his text of Shatabhama Muni, Vedantakalpalapika, and Siddhantabindu come after it. And then comes Advaita Siddhi, as it has been referred to both in Advaita Ratnadakshana and Gurardhadipika, suggesting the latter to be the succeeding works of Mahasiddhanta Saraswati. On the basis of internal references, a tentative chronological order can be made among his devotional works, as I mentioned in the following way. Among the devotional works, I could mention the Mahimnastatra Tika, Bhakti Rasayana, Gurartha Dipika, Bhagavata Purana Prathama Shloka Vyakha, and Dhavila Vyakha in the chronological order. Having found this, general discussion, reference to his different works, and as I've just mentioned, a brief summary of each work, we could get a general estimation of life and works of Mahasiddhanta Saraswati, as I discussed about his life. As of course I mentioned that the life is also can be must to be made based on the hagiographical information available, and mostly the informations are in hagiographical nature rather than the authentic one. Of course, we found different references work. There is also very short references, the colophons in different works of Mahasiddhanta, but other informations mostly are hagiographical and conjectures, and even the translators of Mahasiddhanta's works also have given a bit detailed of Mahasiddhanta's life sketch. So based on the discussions, the short description of Mahasiddhanta's works, and the view what we made yesterday about his biographical sketch, we can have a general estimation of his life and works. The works of Mahasiddhanta reveal his vast erudition and prove him to be an exceptional exponent of Shankara's Advaita Vedanta. He was both an independent author and a commentator of a very high order in Advaita tradition. At the same time, he was an upholder of devotionalism consistent with non-dualistic schools of Vedanta. Out of the 10 books which we consider to have been authored by Mahasiddhanta, Advaita Siddhi, Advaita Ratnadakshana, Vedanta Kalpalatika, and Bhakti Rasayana are independent works. And the remaining works, that is the Bhagavata Purana Prathama Shloka Vyakha, Gurartha Dipika, Hullila Vyakha, Sankshipta Saritika Sarasangraha, Siddhanta Bindu, and the Mahimnastatra Tika, are the commentaries on the original works of different authors. Among the doubtful works, the Anandamandakini and Ishwarputti Padipati Prakasha are independent works, while the Atmabodhutika is a commentary. All the independent works and the commentaries, such as the Gurartha Dipika, Samshipra Sharirika Sarasangraha, and Siddhanta Bindu, explain the Advaita doctrine. We have already mentioned that Advaita Siddhi is treated as a monumental work in Vedantic tradition, in Advaita Vedantic tradition. The sign of critical study of the books he commented upon are explicit in all his commentaries. The Bhakti Rasayana seems to be a guideline to those who can follow the way of devotion as a means of liberation, as it supports the views from the authoritative source of the Gita and the Bhagavata Purana. One needs to have a detailed study of each of the works. Then only we can see the salient features and Mahasiddhanta's general contribution in the field of Advaita Vedanta, at the same time in the field of Bhakti tradition too, in spite of being an ardent follower of Shankara's Advaita Vedanta. The Bhakti Rasayana seems to be, as I mentioned, a guideline to those who can follow the way of devotion as a means of liberation. There you will see that in Bhakti Rasayana itself, Mahasiddhanta followed the Bhagavata Purana's teaching, where he considers the bhakti as the Paramapurusha Artha, which it may seem to be a bit contradictory in the tradition of Abhidhamma. The exposition of the Ishwarapurti Pratiprakasha seems to authenticate the Pancharatra doctrine of the Shatapatha school regarding the term Pranava as compatible with the teaching of the Nishimatapani Upanishad. Although Mahimsatattva is originally based on the Pauranic doctrine in praising Lord Shiva, Madhusudana interpreted this work as praising both Lord Vishnu and Lord Shiva by taking the Shiva Purana, Vishnu Purana, principal Upanishads, Bhagavad Gita, Yoga Sutra, Patanjali, etc. into consideration. So we can conclude from the content of Madhusudana's works that though he said before himself the task of establishing Shankara's Advaita doctrine with the help of impeccable arguments as also the judicious support of Upanishads, no way did it make him a less conventional follower of the Advaita school. Because if you go through Uratudipika, you will find that sometimes he deviates from Shankara. Even it apparently seems, but all along he has shown, you know, his allegiance to this school. Even in Advaita Shri itself, you will find that upquoted verse that Bhungshi Bhivito, that upquoted verse that Bhungshi Bhivito Karad Namunindra Dabhad Purnendi Sundara Mukhad Aurobindo Netrat. This verse you will find in both in Advaita Siddhi and the concluding portion of Bhagavad Gita 2. So the concept of devotion has got a proper place in Advaita when it refers to the so-called Vaishnava Upanishads. His devotional works didn't reverse for the elite Brahmins alone the refuge in the Supreme Reality, since the same recourse is open to the non-Brahmins as well. Unlike the other exponents of Indian philosophical systems, he didn't undertake his life work self-interestedly. He had always room to be provoked by the situation. As a monk, he didn't keep himself aside from all the worldly matters, as we found yesterday. As we mentioned, there is a little detail that he just tried to help the Hindu ascetics when they were attacked by the fakirs, the Muslim ascetics during the time of Akbar. And it is said that he also transformed people belonging to the Kasta and the Vaishya communities into the monkhood. These are all actually it shows his magnanimous attitude, as we mentioned yesterday. His life work paves the way for nurturing the future generation of saints in an ideal manner. As Shankara carried out a reformation among the Hindu monks, Vidyaranya, 14th century CE, in the south, Madhusudana did it in the northern part of India, as is from his appeal to Emperor Akbar, as I mentioned now, for the protection of the Hindu monks. According to the tradition, Madhusudana's place is hardly lower than that of Shankara, Sureshwara, 7th century C, Padmapada, 7th century C, Vachishpati Mishra, 9th century C, Chitshuka, etc., in the field of Advaita Vedanta. So, my friend, just this basically, in nutshell, the salient features or an overall view of Madhusudana's works. And yesterday also I just gave a bit detailed exposition of Madhusudana's life as sketch. We couldn't just here just we have given a brief introduction to each of the works. And one needs to go through each of the works in order to find his philosophical exposition. Both in terms of his Advaitic view and in terms of the the bhakti bhakti view, I mean view on the bhakti tradition. So I find that this could be like a general introduction to Madhusudana's life and works. Thank you so much. And if you have just any query, please just put to the chat box and Nitinji will pass them to me.
So there are two questions as of now. One is some critical writers claim that. Yeah.
Only just to tell you, it has been too early to finish the work. Actually, I didn't have most one thing to say about the works, though I didn't want to, like, just wanted to give a brief introduction to each of the works. Okay. Had I
okay,
to
okay.
Deal with the text in depth, a particular text, so it would have been a bit, bit longer. Okay. So just to have a
spot, okay,
so one. Please.
If you want to go deeper into some of the texts, please go ahead, Dr. Niranjan.
Please.
If you want to go deeper into some of the texts, please go ahead.
Okay.
Yeah, we would love to hear. We still have a lot of time anyways.
Time, yeah. Yeah.
The purpose of this is to make
the
audience familiar with the work. So you can take up two or three
then
works like
Yathvaita
Siddhi and Good Artha Deepika and just,
So anyway, just refer to his Gurartha Deepika or Siddhanta Bindu a bit, bit detail. Okay. So still we have, some time left here. As I mentioned among his works, two works, that is that Gurartha Deepika and the Siddhanta Bindu. Let me give a brief introduction to the work, Siddhanta Bindu. Siddhanta Bindu is basically is a commentary on the Dashasthalika of Shankara. As the very name of Dashasthalika indicates that it consists of 10 dasha, verses, slokas. A creative mind finds in it the essence of the entire Advaita philosophy. Thus, between two familiar terms in Indian philosophy, exposition of philosophy, tattva nirupana, and communicating the theory, tattva upadesha, the Dashasthalika can be placed under the first category. Just I'm mentioning why I'm mentioning, and just giving the the philosophical implication of the term Dashasthalika, because based on which the Siddhanta Bindu is written. The incident that led to the composition of this poem deserves a special mention here. Since the Madhusudana wrote the commentary on Dashasthalika, let me just let you know the reason behind this composition of Shankara. The tradition goes that on being asked who he is by his master Govinda Bhagavat Pada, Shankara expressed his spiritual enlightenment in these 10 indicatives. If you go through the these 10 verses, you will see the entire Advaita gamut is expressed there. It has been narrated by Madhavacharya in his Shankara Digvijaya in the following way. Having renounced the world, the boy Shankara left his village home and advanced northward, seeking his spiritual master. One evening, after traveling a long distance with a staff in hand and clad in a new learned cloth, the young sannyasin reached a forest hermitage on the banks of the Narmada This is actually the background of writing of Shankara's Dashasloki, with the desire to be instructed in Brahma Vidya. Shankara approached the sage Govinda Bhagavat Pada on being advised by the hermits present there. Overwhelmed with Shankara's unwavering devotion to him, Govinda Bhagavat Pada came out of his residence, a cave with a narrow entrance, and put him, Shankara, a question: who are you? Though the master recognized through insight the one who had come to be initiated by him in disguise, in replies, Shankara introduced himself in a unique way: I am the one non-dual auspicious self that remains after the sublation of all else. It goes this way: Eka Vishishtaha Shivaha Kevalaham. Shankara gave an account of his enlightenment in the following manner: Revered Master, I am neither the earth, nor water, nor fire, nor air, nor permanent, nor any of the other properties. I am not the senses and not even the mind. I am the absolute, the specious self, the remainder of the everything else. It goes like this: Navumi Natu. Na bhumi na tu na teju na vayuhu na kham na indriyam va na tesam samuha anikantakatta susupta ke siddha tadik avashishtaha shivah kevalaham. This is the first verse of the of Dashasloki. So highly charmed following the Shankara Digvijaya, Govinda Bhagavat Pada extolled Shankara by saying that Shankara was the great Lord Shankara, Shiva himself. Come on earth. This is all the information we find in Shankara Digvijaya. Likewise, the next goes that, the text goes that, great that greatly pleased with the disciple service, Govinda Bhagavat Pada imparted to Shankara the knowledge of Brahman by explaining the intent of the four great sentences of the Upanishads, Mahavakyas, and gradually the Vedanta Sutras of Vaisya, the son of Parashara and Shatavati. Shuka was the son of Vaisya, who had a disciple named Gurupada, who had in turn a disciple named Govinda Bhagavat Pada, from whom Shankara received Brahma Vidya with a pledge that he, that is Shankara, would do his best to reach the Shastric knowledge that he had received from Govinda Bhagavat Pada to the common folk. This is basically actually the background of writing the Dashasloki of Shankara. Now, let us just briefly introduce to the Dashasloki. The Siddhanta Bindu. Before that, of course, we'll be telling something about the Dashasloki too. There's a lot of discussions, of course. Thus, in the Dashasloki, Shankara affirms the knowledge or the true nature of the absolute Brahman Atman, that is, the real I, the specious pure consciousness, employing the rule of residue, that is, Purusheshanaya. That's what we find in all the verses there, and it ends with the Tadeka Avashishtaha Shiva Kevalaham. What stays on as the remainder of all the experiences, the objective and subjective, have been sublated, is the non-dual self, Brahman, the substratum of I. While the objective experience at the waking stage, Jagrat Avastha, gets sublated at the dream state, Sapna Avastha, and the subjective experience at the dream state disappear at the deep sleep state, Sushupta Avastha, the non-dual self remains ever in its pristine glory, without being affected by any of these states. Thus, the views of other schools, which consider the self as body, mind, etc., are refuted on the ground that they are merely untenable. It is actually the teaching of the first verse, as I mentioned: Na bhumi na tu om, na teju na vayu, na kham nendriyam va, na tesam samuha, anikam takattat susuptaka siddhaha tadeka avashishtaha shivaha kevalaham. This is basically the basic teaching of this verse. As the non-dual consciousness is the cause of the universe, the views of other schools, which regard prarabdha, etc., as the cause of the the pradhana as the cause of the universe are refuted by implications that the four bars, the four bars goes like this: na sankham na shivam na tat pancharatram na jainam na mimamsatakam matam ba vishishta anubhutva vishuddhatmakatta pradika vishishta shiva kevalaham. The supreme self, being in the nature of pure consciousness, is not vitiated by the factors like scriptures, preceptors. However, they contribute to its realization. This is the seventh part. We will see like this, that upiravakatta. This goes like this: na shastra na shastram na shishya na shiksha na chattam na chaham na chayam prapancha swarupa bodha vikalpa sahishnu tadika avashishta shivah kevalah. Thus, in the last verse, in the 10th verse, we see Shankara asks as to how what is established by all the Vedantas to be the non-dual truth or self can be described, since it is bereft of any attributes. If Brahma or the Supreme Self is bereft of any attributes, how can it be described? Shankara mentions in the last verse, na chayekam tadunvat didyam kutahushat namakavalattam na chakavalattam na shunnam na cha shunnam adhidukattat katham shava vedanta vedanta brabhimi. So the grand truth of transcendental identity of the individual self, jiva, with Brahman, the highest reality, expressed through the Upanishadic aphorism that thou art tattvamasi, that awakens the seeker of truth from ignorance with the raguna, is thus the subject matter of this shloki, that prakaran granta written by Shankara. And as is obvious, since that this text, the shloki, in nutshell, delineates the basic teaching of the Vedanta, the commentary on it, the only available commentary on it, written by Madhusudana, it's called Siddhantamata, also will definitely elaborate this view. So let me introduce to you Siddhanta Venu precisely. As we have noted earlier, Siddhanta Venu, that is as a commentary on the Dashashloka by Madhusudana, the etymology of Siddhanta Venu is Siddhanta, doctrine, and Bindu, drop. It suggests that it is a summary or digest of different doctrines of Advaita philosophy. In other words, the very name of the works, that is Siddhanta Bindu, or a drop of the doctrine, may be viewed in the sense that the author here didn't want to engage with long and intricate discussion that is often necessary for conveying to the reader the principal doctrine of Advaita Vedanta. That means, one can say that Madhusudana didn't want to elaborate, unnecessarily not to engage with other views or other things, rather than giving the basic teaching of Advaita Vedanta precisely. The nature of the work, as is found in its brief refutation of other views, in order to establish its own, places it under the category of polemical works, Madhapastana. As I mentioned, that though Siddhanta Venu, you don't find as much hair-splitting reasoning in Siddhanta Venu as you find in Advaita Siddhi. So it can be, that's why it can be regarded, under the, one can put this work under the topical works, Adhikarana Prasthana, rather than in the Padapastana. In Indian philosophical literature. Thus, it brings out, in brief, the philosophical implications of this short work of Shankara, that is, Dashashloki. Though the import of the Upanishad great sentence that the world has been conveyed distinctly through the verses of the Dashashloki, Madhusudana, following the Shankara, elaborates its import in the Siddhanta Bindu in his comments on verse 1-3, as you have just mentioned, the verses. The first one, it goes like this: "Dasuloki, navumin atoyam नतेजन वायुः नखमनेन्द्रियं वा नतेषं समूह अनेकत्वात् सुषुप्तके सिद्धः तदेकावशिष्टः शिवः केवलम्। सेकेंड वन इज नवन्ना नवन्नाश्रम धर्मः नमे धरुणा धनु युगादयोपि अनात्माश्रयम् अमध्य अनात्माश्रयम् मम अद्धावशहनात् अधिकावशिष्टः शिवः केवलम्। थर्ड वन इज न माता पिता वा न वेद न लोकः न लोका न वेद न योग्य न तीर्थं बुर्वन्ति सुषुप्त निरस्तात् शून्यात्मकत्वात् अधिकावशिष्टः शिवः केवलम्। So in this first verse, we see the Mahajana brief explaining the verse, senses of this term "tvam." Actually, Mahajana in the first, you know, as we saw, as he mentioned that the basic teaching of the Vedanta, the Vedanta philosophy is that "tattvamasi mahavakyas." Okay, how the supreme self is related to the individual self, and this is the basic teaching of, the entire Upanishad they came at, and the first verse. In the first verse, Mahajana discussed, as Shankara mentions in the Shastalaki, that the import of the term "tob" is described here. And the next three verses, the import of the term "tod," that supreme self, is discussed. And in the last four verses, the identity of these two terms, "tob" and "tod," is mentioned elaborately in Mahajana's work. And it is if someone reads Siddhanta Bindu with the other sub commentaries available, then it becomes more explicit. But most of the sub commentaries, particularly the Brahmananda's commentary and Naradnavali, is a bit hard compared to other commentaries, Narayana Tirtha's Narayana Tirtha and Purushottama Saraswati's. The most illustrated commentary on Siddhanta Bindu is basically by Abhavakara Shastri. In the first, explaining the first three verses of Dashasulaki, Madhusudana presents the views of various schools, beginning with Charvaka and others, on the nature of the self, decisively examines them, and finally discusses them in order to establish the Advaita view that the self is absolute and pure consciousness. That is also devoid of any attribute. Due to ignorance, avidya or ajnana, the self comes to be bestowed with the attributes of agency, kartitva, etc. However, these do not concern the self at all, as it is already mentioned that tadeka avashishtaha shivaha kapalam. That means what? That means it's just as I mentioned following the method of residue, that the supreme self, it always shines in its pristine glory. However, this don't concern the self at all. Okay, the empirical existence jagat parpancha is a mere superimposition on Brahman by nescience and avidya. The positive bhava and the indeterminable anirvachaniya nature of avidya, the mutual superimposition, tadatmadhasa of the self and the not self, which is the cause of I and mind, and the various methods on the interpretation of the great sentences that the word, such as the exclusive implication, you know, the Vedantic method of explaining this Mahavakya. The first one is jahad ajahad lakshana, or we call jahal lakshana, non-exclusive implication, ajahal lakshana, an exclusive non-exclusive implication, jahat ajahat lakshana. If we need to explain, because this is a technical term, so we are just introducing here, so we would have another occasion to discuss all this technical term, though I'm not going into detail in this terms here. So the commentary then expounds the various theories about the nature of the individual self, jiva, the reflection theory, patibimbavada, that is the semblance theory, avahasavada, and limitation theory of Chedavada. These are the basic, the fundamental Vedantic theories, regarding the relation between the supreme self and the individual self. The Madhusudana admits the theory that perception is creation, drishti srishti vada, to be the chief Vedantic doctrine, mukha Vedanta siddhanta. And this is in the first, you know, in the commentary on the first three verses, Madhusudana discusses all these things in detail. In the next three verses, 4, 5, and 6, we see Madhusudana elaborates the theories of various schools with regard to the cause of the universe. While expounding the import of the term Tad in Tattvamasi Mahavakya, Madhusudana establishes the Vedantic view that Brahman associated with illusion, Mitha, is both the material and efficient cause, Nimitta Karana, of the universe. Though the universe is full of misery, which is superimposed by Avidya on Brahman, and in two ways affects the substrate Brahman, which is without qualities such as color, size, etc., and not an object of cognition, Brahman is itself self-luminous. Madhusudana's commentary, these are in short, just you can do it here, the na shankam na vedam, na shankam na shaivam, na tu pancharatram, na jainam na mimamsudam, matamba, visheshtanabhutta, shuddhatmakatta, tadeka, visheshtaha, shiva, kabalaham. The fourth verse, the fifth is, na chordam, na chadu, na cha antar, na vajjam, na madhyam, na tirjam, na purva, vanadik, vyodbhapkatta, अखंडिक रूप तदेक अवशिष्ट शिव केवल अहम. नेक्स्ट वन द सिक्स्थ वन, न शुक्लम न कृष्णम न रक्तम न पीतम न कुब्जम न पीनम न रस्यम न दीर्घम अरूपम तथा ज्योतिरकत्वात्वा तदेक अवशिष्ट शिव केवल अहम. द सेवेंथ वन, न शास्त्र न शास्त्रम न शिष्य न शिक्षा न चत्तम न चाहम न चयम प्रपंच स्वरूप अवबोध विकल्प सहिष्णु तदेक अवशिष्ट शिव केवल अहम. Because in these four verses, you know, as I mentioned, describe the nature of the Supreme Self, that is called Tad. In the last three verses, 7, 8, 9, last four verses, 7 to 10, that means the first three verses deal with the import of the term Tom. The next three verses deal with the import of the term thought, and the last four verses deal with the the relation of Tom and the identical relation of Tom and thought, that is the import of the Tattvamasi Mahavakya. Thus Madhusudana's commentary in verse 7 to 10 advocates the transcendental unity between Tom and thought of the two categories recognized in Aditya, namely the seeker, the seer, drik, and the seeing, drishya. The seer is non-dual and pure consciousness, though due to limiting adjuncts, these are original views in the tradition, the adjuncts upadhi, it appears threefold. We know that why, though we are that we are identical with Brahman, but we are not able to recognize that we are feel that we are identified with Brahman, because due to the adjuncts, limiting adjuncts upadhi, that is also caused by our ignorance. It appears threefold. God is Chara, that means when the individual self is limited by upadhi, it appears threefold, that is God, Ishvara, the individual self, Jiva, and the witness is that Sakshin. The three states of waking, dream, and deep sleep, as it is mentioned, the Jagrat, Shapna, and Sushupta Avastha of the Jiva are also discussed here in detail and in this connection. The Vedanta theory of creation, Srishti, the theory of Panchikarana is explained in detail, quintuplication, together with the theory of triplication, Trividkarana, which is also accepted by certain Advaitic writers. The different kinds of resolution, polaya, are also referred to here. All these are found in Madhusudana's commentary on verse 8 of the Sloki, as we just read out. The commentary continues to explain the concept of the witness itself and maintains that Brahman, being the base of all proofs, cannot be spoken of. Thus, we get a brief and yet adequate account of Advaita philosophy from this work. At the end of the work, Madhusudana mentions that he undertook this work at the repeated request of his disciple Balabhadra, as I mentioned yesterday, which is mentioned that at the request of my disciple Balabhadra Bhattacharya, I composed this work. That's why we began with this Bhattacharya. Is a familiar Bengali surname in the Brahmin communities. So based on this reference also, we can guess that Madhusudana must have been born in Bengal. This work is pregnant with much content, like the Usha Ling Jain Chintamani of Gangesh Upadhyaya. It seems that at the last, the conclusion of Siddhantavindu, Madhusudana has compared this work, this Siddhantavindu, with the Tattva Chintamani of Gangesh Upadhyaya, which is the Magnum of us in the tradition of Nambunaya, that is new logic in Indian tradition, is written by Gangesh Upadhyaya of 16th century. It is an assertion that can be corroborated if we view that the Siddhantavindu only explains in a nutshell what is available in Madhusudana's masterpiece of Advaita Siddhi, a landmark in the history of the Vedantic dialectics. As I mentioned, that is Advaita Siddhi is the masterpiece, the magnum opus of Madhusudana. But in Siddhantavindu, though we may not find as much head splitting reasoning in Siddhantavindu as we find in Advaita Siddhi, but based on the discussion, based on the contents of the Siddhantavindu, we could just mention this work as an independent work, because it stands to be an independent work on its own right. Though different editions of the Siddhantavindu have been brought out along with the commentaries, both in original Sanskrit and with translations, some of which are in vernaculars. Of course, the editions of Harihara Shastri, Vasudeva Shastri Abhankar, Trambakar Shastri, Pulla Chandra Shekhar Divanji, Mahadev Gangadhar Varkre, A. Subramanya Shastri, M. V. Ashwarabhanya Shastri are mainly available in the original Sanskrit and treated to be authentic and reliable. Actually, as you mentioned, the famous available commentaries on Siddhantavindu mentioned where we made chronologically of the Bindusandipana. First one is Bindusandipana, Purushottama Saraswati. As I mentioned, that Purushottama Saraswati seems to be one of the disciples of Madhusudana. The Laghu Vyakha of Narayana Tirtha, 17th century C. Purushottama belongs to 16th century C. The Narayana Nayaratnavali, Brahmananda Saraswati of 17th century C, and the Siddhantavindu of Siddhanta Sindhu of Ramaraya with that copy. It is a later one, the 21st century. You can say it is sub-commentary on Siddhantavindu. And the Bindu Sandipana of Vasudeva Shastri of Bhankar, which is the most elucidate commentary in Sanskrit in original. On Siddhantavindu. Besides the lucid summary of the Siddhantavindu called Siddhantavindu Shara by Taranatha Tarkabhagish, Tarkabhachishpati, it was composed in 1793 Shakabda, that is 1871 C, has come down to us. So these are basically the commentaries and sub commentaries available on Siddhantavindu, which have come down to us. While the Bindusandipana is very brief and helpful in one respect, that it identifies almost all the quotations used in Siddhantavindu by pointing out their sources. Laghu Vyakha, I'm just giving a brief introduction to the commentaries available, but it's very hard to understand particularly Nayaratnavali because it is fully written in a Bonaya language. Sometimes one sentence goes it covers one page sometimes. So until unless somebody had mastery on Nabbunaya, it is very, very, very hard to crack this text. So Laghu Vyakha is very useful in understanding the text. Nayaratnavali is extensive, having followed Nabbunaya's style of writing. And based on Laghu Vyakha, Siddhantavindu explains the text elaborately and often goes beyond its actual context, the Bindu Prabhupada by Bhakta Shastri is much lucid and helpful for the beginners to grasp the intent of the text. Thus, though the Siddhanta Bindu Sara by Prabhupada Kavi cannot be considered to be a proper commentary on Siddhanta Bindu, but a good summary of it seems to be the earliest published elucidation of Siddhanta Bindu in Sanskrit available. As we have mentioned earlier too, the other works of Madhusudana, where the Siddhanta Bindu is referred to, are the Advaita Siddhi, Bhakti Rasayana, Vedanta Kalpalatika, and Gunartadipika. That means in these works, the Siddhanta Bindu is referred to. And while the Vedanta Kalpalatika of the author is referred to in the Siddhanta Bindu, thus, this is the cross references of other works to Siddhanta Bindu. We have some time, 10 or 15 minutes, just we can have a brief introduction about another work of Saraswati that's called Gunartadipika. I mentioned that it's a running commentary on Bhagavad Gita. As I mentioned that it's a running commentary on Bhagavad Gita called Gunartadipika. Just a minute. The title of the Gunartadipika means literally Gunartadipika. If we just split the term like this, Gunartadipika. The Gunartadipika, the illumination of the hidden meaning. The illumination of Dipika, illumination, artha, meaning, Guna means the hidden. So the illumination of the hidden meaning, it is evident that for Madhusudana, the text of the Bhagavad Gita is not always transparent, and that he considers his work to reveal the true import of the text, which it may be implied has been missed by other interpretations. So it could be like, you know, a reason why Madhusudana undertook to write a commentary on the Bhagavad Gita, though there are a number of Advaita commentaries available at that time too. Though he mentioned yesterday that he was asked by his teachers to write a commentary on this. As will be discussed in due course, of course, just I've discussed in my work, Madhusudana's decision to name his commentary Gunartadipika extensive study of Shankara's commentary on the Bhagavad Gita may also mean that Madhusudana wants to illuminate the hidden meaning of Shankara's Bhagavad Gita commentary. Though if we just take this, okay, the Gunartha main, the Gunartadipika means the illumination of the hidden meaning of the inner meaning, the hidden meaning, hidden meaning. At the same time, we can just also mention that he wanted to bring out, shed light on the hidden meaning of Shankara's view on the text. So in his own words, Madhusudana affirms a philosophy which recognizes other means of self-realization, such as yoga, devotion to God, bhakti, and the analytical approach of the Shankara. In spite of being an ardent follower of Shankara Vedanta, Madhusudana's principal aim in commenting on the Bhagavad Gita to have been to a philosophical justification for the way of devotion bhakti marga that he followed himself. Therefore, there are some, give a brief sketch of the salient features of this text. Madhusudana divides the Bhagavad Gita into three sections, which is six chapters each, offering a unique justification for it. This is the way, salient features of Madhusudana's Gita commentary. There's no other previous acharyas has divided Bhagavad Gita explicitly in three khandas. According to him, the first six chapters deal with the means relating to the path of sacrifice and social duty, karma yoga. This, however, is considered merely as a means to the final goal, which is liberation, moksha. Madhusudana seeks to establish logically the essence of the pure self indicated by the term thou, tam, of the Upanishad dictum that thou art tattamasi. We have just referred to Siddhanta Bindu, the first three verses of the Shastalaki describe the nature of individual self. The next three verses describe the import and the nature of Supreme Self, and the last four verses describe the relation of the Supreme Self and the individual self, that is the identity of Tam and Tat. The same way here also, while writing the commentary on Bhagavad Gita, Madhusudana has also tried to bring out the import of Tattamasi Mahavakya. So he mentions that the first six chapters of the Bhagavad Gita deal with, as is obvious, it deal with karma yoga. So he mentioned that the import of the term tam is explained here in the first six chapters. So the middle six chapters deal with the means relating to the yoga of devotion, bhakti yoga, making a transition from action karma to knowledge dhyana, visible. It determines the concept of that tat, the principle of supreme reality, as you mentioned, through instruction of devotion to and worship of the deity. So the next six chapters, the 7 to 12 chapters, deal with, as per Madhusudana, deal with the term thought, which actually, the principle of supreme reality thought through instruction of devotion to and worship of the deity. Here, we see that first the three, the 7 to 12, the chapters deal with the term thought, that is the supreme self. We'll be just discussing how Madhusudana has divided into the text in three khandas. We have just mentioned that he has followed the same principle as he followed while writing the Siddhanta Bindu. The six last chapters expound the yoga of knowledge, Gyan Yoga, leading to the great equations made in Tattvamasi, that is the identity of Tat and Tam. That means the first six chapters deal with Tam, the next six chapters deal with Tat, and the last six chapters deal with identity of Tam and Tat, as is found in Siddhanta Bindu also. Among the remarkable features of this commentary, one may highlight from the start his attempted synthesis of the path of knowledge, jnana, and devotion, bhakti, as well as its attempt to reconcile as much as possible the other Vedic schools of philosophy with the main tenets of Advaitic thought. Unlike other commentaries on the Bhagavad Gita, it deals with almost every single word of the text, attributing to each a most nuanced kind of connotation. Madhusudana's unique style in the commentary can be seen in his expressions of abundant devotion of God, coupled with the firm adherence to Shankara's Advaita, evident in his original verses at the beginning and at the end of the chapters. In most of the chapters, you know, Madhusudana at the beginning, either in the beginning or at the end of the chapters, Madhusudana paid much homage to his gurus. At the beginning, at the very beginning of the text, Madhusudana paid homage to Shankara and started his commentary. Madhusudana points out variant readings of the text of Bhagavad Gita too, even where they don't substantially impact his understanding of the text. That means one of the basic features of this text is Madhusudana commented on each and every word of the text. I noted earlier that Patanjali's system of yoga also explained extensively in this text, the Yoga Sutra, Yoga Vasishta, has also been frequently referred to. Amidst all these remarkable features, the sole idea of complete surrender to God, Sharanagati, a total union of the individual self with the absolute one, and a merger of the unqualified nirguna with the qualified saguna through love and devotion, bhakti, occupy the central place in the text of Bhagavad of Murata Deepika. In the concluding part of the book, the author justifies the synthesis of devotion, bhakti, action, karma, and knowledge, jnana. In spite of disagreements at times with Shankara's explanation of the Bhagavad Gita, Madhusudana doesn't deviate from the fundamental Advaita tenets of Shankara. So we have just all the references here in his text itself. Thus, it would seem that Madhusudana was willing to differ from Shankara's interpretation of the Bhagavad Gita, but not from his formulation of Advaita doctrine of Advaita Siddhanta. Okay. So one might ask whether he deviated from Shankara's view in the Bhagavad Gita. It said that he must have tried to deviate from the interpretation of Shankara's, the interpretation of Shankara's Bhagavad Gita, but not from the formulations of Advaita doctrine as propounded by Shankara. In a few important instances, however, Madhusudana does offer an independent understanding of basic doctrine, such as when he argues that by the knowledge of the Vedantic great sentences, Mahavakyas, we realize none but the supreme reality, Vasudeva, Krishna. in this text itself, in Bhagavad Gita, you find that he equated the supreme self with Vasudeva, Krishna. This is in sharp contrast to Shankara, for whom the absolute Brahman is devoid of any personal characteristic. You call it nirguna. Since we are just giving a brief introduction to this text, introduction to this. So I should mention here, the main editions of Bhagavad Gita are those of Kashinath Shastri Agassiz. It's published in 1912. Then we have Vasudeva Lakshman Shastri Panchika. These are the original editions. 1999 we got. Then we have Jivarama Dalurama Shastri edition, 2001. Then variant readings, Pathaveda of Madhusudana's commentary are found in all the three editions, particularly these three Sanskrit editions, the original editions we found. And we find that Pathaveda also different variant readings also are there if one consults these three editions. In my work, basically, I have just depended on this Panchika's edition only. And it's the only sub-commentary on Gurudatta Deepika is written by the 19th century Nayayika from Mithila, named Bachchajha. The commentary is the sub-commentary is called Gurudatta Tattvalaka. Though it is not a complete sub-commentary on Gurudatta Deepika, but in some places, Bachchan has elaborately, you know, explained Muslim's interpretation, though it is mainly written in Nubana language because Bachchan was a Nubanayaka, basically. Then you also, another sub-commentary on the Gurutubika by Horijasa Mishra, though it is just mentioned in the encyclopedia, but we didn't get this book in printed form. We have just only got this Bachchan's Gurutubika Tattaloka. And it should be mentioned that very few works, have been done on this Gurutubika Tattaloka, and I haven't come across any work so far, even an article too on Gurutubika Tattaloka. Bachchan's work is not a complete commentary, as I mentioned, on the Gurutubika, and is heavily technical, revealing the high Nubanaya scholarship of the author, but is, however, very original in nature. Thus, though of limited use, it may not be ignored in our study of if somebody wants to have an in-depth study of Muslim Gurutubika. So I could just mention with other things also. And then with regards to the available translation of this work, Gurutubika, we have found two in English, one by Swami Gambhirananda, which is by Ramakrishna Mission. Then another one is a very old one by Shishir Kumar Gupta. I think it is not available in the market now. In addition, there are some Hindi translations also by Swami Sunatana Devji Maharaj, Hariharo Kipalu Divedi, and the recent one by Professor Madan Mohan Agrawal, and a Bengali translation also by Bhutanatha Shaktitirtha. These things which I just come across. Then we could mention that I mentioned earlier the Gurutubika, of course, so other commentaries also are referred to in this, in Gurutubika. The mention will be made of Ramanuja, though it is implicitly, and Jayatirtha of Madhya Sampradaya. In later commentarial literature on the Bhagavad Gita, we find explicit reference to the Gurutubika in other commentaries also, like Venkatanatha, the teacher of Dharmaraja Dhrinda, then Nilakantashuri, the famous commentator of Mahabharata, then Vallabhacharya, 17th century, the grandson of Vallabhacharya, the founder of Shuddhadvaita school, then Purushottamji, 18th century, as a proponent of Shuddhadvaita school, and Vishwanatha Chakravarti, I mentioned just earlier, Vishwanatha of Gaudiya Vaishnava, Gaudiya Vaishnavas, and then Bharadeva Vidyabhushan, Gaudiya Sampradaya, and Dhanapati Shuri of Adhita Sampradaya. So these are the works, the Bhagavad Gita commentaries of these writers, starting from Venkatanatha, Nilakanta Shuri, then Purushottama, and Vishwanatha Chakravarti, Bharadeva Vidyabhushan, we find the reference to Gurutubika. But copious anonymous citations confirm their oneness of the views expressed in the Gurutubika. Though sometimes in these works, they have referred to Bhagavad Gita, and they have mostly in support of their view, but the anonymous citations also confirm their oneness of the view expressed in the Gita. Sometimes they haven't mentioned explicitly, but it seems that they were aware. Some of the authors, in the commentaries of Bhagavad Gita also, some of the commentators didn't mention explicitly Madhusudana's work on Gurutubika, but the copious references indicate that they were aware of his works. So anyway, just I have given a brief an introduction to both the work of Gurutubika and the Siddhanta Bindu of Madhusudana, along with a brief introduction to other texts. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Niranjan sir. These introductions are very much helpful, because you know, simply knowing the names of the works would not have been much as helpful as knowing that kind of overview of a summary of what they contained. I am sure this has increased interest in you know, interest among many of our viewers to take up a study of these texts. And I will suggest for the benefit of the viewers that Gudartha Deepika of Madhusudana has been translated to English by Swami Gambhirananda of Ramakrishna Ashram, and it is widely available on Amazon and everywhere else. So please read it. I think even Siddhanta Bindu.
Yeah, there are number of English translations.
Yes, even
there are number of English translations.
Even Siddhanta Bindu has been translated into English. Though I don't think Advaita Siddhi has been translated, right?
No, partially it has been translated partially. Partially it has been translated. So someone should take this venture to translate Advaita Siddhi.
One of my friend Shri Venkat Raghavanji is actually doing it, the translation. He's putting it on his blog. He is a Advaita Vedantin and belonging to traditional sampradaya, so to speak.
So he has undertaken to translate the entire text.
Advaita Siddhi, yes.
The entire text?
Yes. He has just started, I think. He posts it in a group I am part of, as a blog post he's doing in bits and pieces. I mean, in the sense of he has started it and from one place, but it is available online. I think he has finished a few chapters of it already, I think.
Now, in Advaita Vedanta list, I found some of the posts, on Advaita Siddhi.
Yes, there only. I think that is by the same person we are speaking. Venkat Raghavanji, I think he stays in UK. I think he also lives in UK. So we have a few questions I would like you to take up. Somebody is noting that Advaita Siddhi's first part of three has been translated to English by Pandit Ganganath Jha. I was not aware of this. So thank you for the information. So the first, I think one question we have is, some critical writers claim
One minute, not the entire, the first part, first part means, the Patham Mittatu is translated into an English by Ganganath Jha. It's a very archived English. But Ganganath Jha translated a number of works in English. It is available with me also.
I have read his translation of Medhatithi's Manubhashya and Manu.
Yes, and he has translated the Shloka Vartika too.
Yeah.
Number of philosophical texts.
Shloka Vartika of Kumarila Bhatta?
Yeah, he translated into English.
Oh, okay.
I'm not very sure whether the entire one or partially. Mm-hmm. But I'm having, I think you must have purchased it.
Okay.
No, I don't know. The English translation I didn't get, but the Moolam I am having. Yeah.
Okay.
But he has translated it into English too.
Okay.
Number of works he translated into English.
Mm-hmm.
And these are being reprinted by Parimal and other publishers.
Mm-hmm. The Medhatithi Bhashya is very good actually. Okay. So the one important question that we have got is, some critical writers claim that Madhusudana had to take a much softer stand on some aspects to defend Advaita against Nayamrita in Advaita Siddhi. I am not sure what he means by softer stand, but what are your views on this? I mean, can you shed more light on the Nayamrita Advaita Siddhi debate?
It is like, if I understand, the question. He asked that Madhusudana took a bit soft view while writing Advaita Siddhi.
Yes.
I don't think that he took, though, as I mentioned, that it is very difficult to have my purpose is to say that in the world, three or four people may understand Advaita Siddhi. You know, to say like, you could say in the world, the three, four people might, you know, understand this. That's true. As you know, that in Madras now, Munidhar Shastriji is there. Then our earlier award, Godavenkata Shastri girl, I had the opportunity to study, you know, a few days with him when I was in Chennai. So, but I don't think like Mushudana took a soft stance while writing Advaita Siddhi against the Madhva Sampradaya. That Advaita Ratnarakshana, in Advaita Ratnarakshana, Mushudana vehemently criticized Shankara Mishra. Shankara Mishra is a dualist, okay. And at the beginning of the work itself, Madhusudana, vehemently criticized. I don't have the text here, and even he went to some extent to regard him as a thief, you know, like thief in the sense that, you know, when he just wanted to pour his, you can say, like his disliking or criticism against this dualistic school, the Adnayakas in general. But in Advaita Siddhi, since Advaita Siddhi is considered to be the magnum opus of Mahajana Saraswati, and among all his works, Advaita Siddhi, when, as I mentioned, that Advaita Siddhi is considered to be the last original work in post Shankara tradition, though you will find Madhusudana's full-fledged efforts. To establish the basic teaching, best teaching of Advaita Vedanta. But since the story goes like that, he was asked by his guru to write, to defend Advaita Siddhi from the clutch of, you know, the dualistic schools. And that time Madhva Sampradaya dualistic school was the prominent enemies of this tradition. Advaita Vedanta. And as you know, the Shankara was born in 7th or 8th century, and after like 300 or 400 years after Shankara, nobody could question. The first question came from Ramanujan Vishnu Vedanta, and gradually then other bhakti schools also started, you know, criticizing Advaita Vedanta in order to establish their own view. But though in Advaita Siddhi we have that, as I just mentioned, the same references, that oft-quoted verse, you know, Bhangshi Bhushita Karat, Nabunita Dabhat, Pitambara, Sundaram Mukhat, Arbindu Netrat, Krishnat Param, Kimopitattu Mahavuna Jani. These oft-quoted verses, it shows like, you know, if somebody sees this verse abruptly in Advaita Siddhi, he or she might think that Madhusudana has just poured his devotional, sentiment, even in Advaita Siddhi itself, which is actually considered to be the digest of Advaita Vedanta or a fundamental work on Advaita Vedanta. At the same time, he has mentioned this verse, referred to this verse in Bhagavad Gita itself. I think in the beginning of, or the end of chapter 15, Purushottama Yoga, and at the end of Bhagavad Gita, Gurupratipika, that means the 18th chapter, he has mentioned this verse too. So on the basis of this reference, one might could say that Madhusudana is a bit soft in attacking dualists, the Madhva Sampradaya. But I don't think that he was soft, left any stone unturned to criticize his opponents.
Thank you, Dr. Niranjan. I think we have just one more question. Could you please mention where to get the copy of Preceptors of Advaita? I think the first book that you showed.
This book is very much available with Samatha, Chennai, Samatha book.
I think yeah. It is also available on Amazon. You can just
it could be, of course. That time I was in Chennai and I went that shop that is in, you know, that is in Mount Road. That is in Mount Road. I think it is Mount Road. So I used to go and collect it from that shop, and the computer workshop Shankara is available with them. That Samatha edition, 10 volumes.
Okay.
Earlier, actually, there is a reprint of earlier edition. I think first it was published from Secunderabad.
Which one? The complete works of...
No, this Preceptor Sabadvaita.
Okay.
Yeah, I think it was published in 1961 or sometime from Secunderabad. Then it is the reprint of on that book from Samatha. It's a very good, you know, one should, in order to have a, you can say the parampara, a glimpse of the parampara of the, I mean, Advaita tradition. I think there are 100 or more than nearly 100 preceptors detail you will find in this book. It's a very good one. It's a very good, and there is that Ashivani of Paramacharya also is given here. Kamakati, Paramacharya's. It's a very, very good one. It starts with Vasishtha. It starts with Vasishtha. To 61 Jagadgurus, you know, I mean, preceptors detail you will find here. And it ends with Chandrasekhar Sridhar Swamigal. So it's a very good supplement to this series, what you have started, this preceptors of Jagadgurus.
Thank you. I was not aware of that book. I would.
Somebody like, you know, in Advaita Granthulish, somebody mentioned. When Shubhuji just mentioned my talk, okay. Mm-hmm. So, in response to that, you know, post, somebody mentioned that okay, this book could be a supplement. Of course, I was aware of that, and I was having the book. Yeah,
I was aware of Tangaswamiji's that bibliography of Vedanta. I have that book.
Yeah, it's a good one. Of course, it's a bibliography. It's a bibliography. Yeah. That book is, I don't think it is available in Madras University. I purchased it long back when I was there, but I don't think it's available. It's out of stock.
It's a very good one.
Very authentic one.
Good one. Thank you, Dr. Niranjan sir, and we are almost towards the end of the session, and it was a extremely fantastic session, and to hear about Madhusudana Saraswati is a music to the ears, especially for someone like me personally, who has studied Madhusudana Saraswati to some extent and greatly admire him, and his commentary that Gudartha Deepaka is my favorite commentary on Bhagavad Gita. And this lecture has been personally enriching to me, and thank you for agreeing to come on our show. And we will be inviting Dr. Niranjan Sahai again next month to speak more on the topic of bhakti in Advaita Vedanta. And next week we will have other events on Weekend with Wisdom and other things. So follow our posts on Facebook, Twitter, or Instagram, and we will keep you updated. With this, we conclude this session. Shri Gurubhyo Namaha.
Sorry, I am much humbled, you know, to have been invited by you, to have given me an opportunity to speak before you. And I just request the audience to send their feedback so that we can enrich myself. Okay, if the feedback I receive, then you'll help me to point out my drawbacks, and so that I can just develop myself. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you. And I just see in the chat that there is a Kannada translation of Gudartha Deepika available from Vedanta Bharati, Bangalore. So okay. any Kannada people in the audience, please have a check out of the book. It's a must read. So with this, we conclude the session. Shri Gurubhyo Namaha.
Namaste.